Michelle used 240 to pass her FTCE Reading K-12. She wrote to us saying that even though there are other study resources out there, 240 was the invaluable resource that she recommends. Michelle, we love getting teacher seals of approval. My name is Jessica Solano, and I've worked in education in Florida since 2008. And in 2017, I was awarded Florida Teacher of the Year. This video is going to prepare you for the FTCE Reading K-12 test, number 035. And this video is going to cover three things: what's on the test and how to study for it, the most likely concepts that'll show up, and we're going to look at a few practice questions. Are you ready to jump into it? Let's take the plunge. The FTCE reading exam consists of 9 competencies. Whew, that's a lot. Let's simplify those titles a little bit. This exam covers research and theories of reading processes, text type and structures, reading assessment and evaluation, supporting reading, language acquisition and beginning reading, phonics and word recognition, vocabulary, fluency and comprehension, and reading programs. So basically, this exam is all about teaching reading. The test is approximately 100 multiple choice questions in all, and each competency is worth between 10 and 15% of the exam. Let's go over one key concept from each competency. We'll start with the heart of what reading really is, which are also the topics that carry a little more weight for your score. Let's discuss competency 5, language acquisition and beginning reading. When it comes to beginning reading, the stages of word recognition are essential to know. Let's take a peek inside our study guide to hear all about the first one, the pre-alphabetic stage.
Let's discuss the 5 stages of word recognition. First is the pre-alphabetic stage. Students in this stage have no working knowledge of the alphabetic system. When these students read words, their reading is based solely on recognition and memorization. For example, students may say Target when they see the recognizable logo as they pass the store. These students require direct instruction on letter-sound relationships. They are likely to need practice with foundational reading skills, such as phonemic awareness and print concepts. Because they are not yet able to decode, predictable repetitive texts are especially useful in this stage. Also, consider using books that retell familiar nursery rhymes to help students in this stage connect the words in the memorized rhymes to text represented on the page.
There are 4 more stages in the progression: partial alphabetic, full alphabetic, consolidated alphabetic, and automatic. We have them covered for you, along with everything else you need to know for your exam in our 240 study guide. Let's keep on moving into our next competency: phonics and word recognition. Definitely a big one when it comes to learning to read. On this exam, questions about phonemic awareness come up in this competency. Phonemic awareness is the ability to hear and use individual units of sounds, or phonemes. Phonemes are the smallest individual sounds in a word. For example, the word sock has 3 phonemes: s, a, k. There are several skills that fall under phonemic awareness, which develop in a simple to complex progression. Phoneme isolation is the ability to separate a single sound in a position of a word. For example, j is the first sound in jet. Phoneme blending is the ability to blend individual sounds to make a word. J, e, t makes jet. Phoneme segmentation is the ability to break down a word into separate sounds. Jet is made from j, e, t. Phoneme addition is the ability to add one phoneme to a word. Jet with s at the end sounds like jets. Phoneme deletion is the ability to remove a phoneme from a word. Jet without the j sounds like et. Phoneme substitution is the ability to replace a phoneme in a word with another. Changing the j in jet to s sounds like set. Okay, now let's get set to jet to the next competency. The next competency we'll look at is vocabulary. There's lots more to know under phonics and word recognition. Luckily, we break it all down for you in our FTCE Reading Study Guide. Questions in this category will involve how to teach students new words, but not just any words. There are three levels or tiers of vocabulary words. Tier 1 consists of basic vocabulary, meaning common words that are already familiar to students when they enter school, such as ball, shoe, or stop. These words do not need to be taught in a classroom setting. Tier 2 is made up of high-frequency academic words, or words that students will encounter frequently in multiple content areas. Many of these are process words that commonly appear in assessments, like describe, explain, or evaluate. Tier 3 consists of low-frequency, domain-specific words. These are academic words that are specific to a particular content area or discipline. These are words that would appear in a subject-specific textbook or in the glossary of an informational text. A few examples of Tier 3 words would be photosynthesis, square root, or economy. You'll need to be prepared to identify words that belong in each tier. Nailing these tiers will ensure your kids have no fears and help them when a new challenge appears. Okay, now that your students have an increased vocabulary, they're ready to move on to really understand and learn from what they're reading. And that's the goal, isn't it? I'm talking about fluency and comprehension. This is the biggest category, and it's worth 15% of your exam. Fluency is the ability to read with accuracy, prosody, and appropriate speed. Fluency is strongly tied to reading comprehension. Improving students' fluency improves their ability to comprehend what they read. When students are able to read fluently, they're not struggling to sound out words, so they can concentrate on the meaning of what they're reading. Now I'm going to go over some key concepts to know for comprehension. To learn more about fluency and to really get the confidence you deserve to pass the test, you need to get the 240 Study Guide. Our 240 Study Guides have hundreds of questions, in-depth videos, and test-aligned study materials, so you can get the depth you need to pass. Now, for comprehension. There are different levels of reading comprehension and various specific strategies students will need to learn. For your exam, you'll need to know some common techniques for teaching reading comprehension. There are lots, but I have a good one to get into your toolbox. It's the KWL chart. You know, I once had a student who thought it stood for knowledge, win, or lose, and then I had another student who referred to it as our cool chart. I mean, it is pretty cool, but here's what it really stands for. Know, want to know, and learned. A KWL is a graphic organizer used to record what students know, what they want to know, and then what they learned about the topic. You fill in the K and W portions together before reading the text, and then you can come back to the L section afterwards. So now that we know a technique to build comprehension, what do we want to know next? Text types and structures. Let's jump back up to Competency 2 and discuss the types of text that will come up on the exam. Don't worry, I promise I won't forget about Competency 1. A few important concepts to know here are identifying types of organization, also known as text structures, selecting and using multicultural literature, and understanding literary genres. And if you don't understand each of these concepts, because you need to, use the 240 Study Guide. It'll save you a lot of time, a lot of money, and a lot of worry. Teachers have so much on their plate. Don't make yourself worry about the test. I'm going to focus on literary genres and walk you through the most important things to know. We know that texts can be divided into two big categories, fiction and nonfiction. Well, each of those categories is made up of genres. You'll need to be able to identify these genres and analyze their characteristics. Common nonfiction genres to know are biography, autobiography, and memoir. These are all about the lives of real people. You should also be familiar with expository text, procedural text, and persuasive text. These are all informational texts which are fact-based. They often include features like headings, captions, and glossaries. Common fiction genres to know are fairy tale, fantasy, folktale, fable, myth, and realistic fiction. These are all also classified as narrative texts because they tell a story. You'll also need to know poetry and drama.
Drama.
Such a fun one. To study or not to study? That is the question. Actually, there's no question. You really should study for the exam. Next up is reading assessment and evaluation. This section is all about the different kinds of assessments you may give your students and analyzing and interpreting the results. It's important to use assessment to continually monitor student growth and performance, and then use the results to alter your instruction and keep students moving forward. Here's a tip. Reading assessments should take place with texts that are continuous, or those that use sentences and paragraphs. Non-continuous texts include graphs, lists, or images. A key assessment that you could see on your exam is the Informal Reading Inventory, or IRI. The IRI is a multi-step reading assessment used to gauge a student's oral and silent reading abilities. It monitors students' reading for accurate phonemic awareness, phonics, fluency, vocabulary, and comprehension. During an IRI, a teacher will take notes of student errors, as well as use guided questions to assess a student's comprehension of the text read. And there you have it, assessment and evaluation. You'll be taking an assessment about an assessment. Kind of meta, isn't it? We're almost there. You're doing great. Only 3 more competencies to go, and then you can test your knowledge with some practice questions. It's time to go over supporting reading. And this is an important one too, because it covers all the things you need to do to make learning happen. So things like how to group kids effectively and which techniques to use to teach specific reading objectives. There are many instructional strategies to use when teaching reading, but I'm going to explain one in particular that might come up on your test. It's the question-answer relationship, or QAR strategy. The question-answer relationship strategy is designed to help students identify key information after reading. There are 4 types of questions based in QAR. Write their questions. The answer to the question is word for word in the text. An example would be, who is the protagonist? Think and search questions. The answer is available in the text, but might require deeper thought or searching. For example, asking how one event in the story led to another. Author and you questions. The answer can be found by activating prior knowledge and making connections with the author. For instance, what do you think will happen after that? And finally, on my own questions. The answer is not necessarily found in the text. This includes questions like, how would you feel if that happened to you? So that's QAR. It's a great framework to use to make sure your questions target different levels of comprehension. But if you have any more questions, write them in the comments and we'll help you out. And click the link in the description to get the study guide that we made specifically for the FTCE Reading K-12 test. Remember when I told you I'd get back to Competency 1? Well, here we are. It's time for research and theories of reading processes. Just like competencies 2, 3, 4, and 9, this one's only worth 10% of your test, but that's about 10 questions, so you can't afford to stop studying here. You'll need to know your learning theories. In the classroom, they help teachers troubleshoot challenges, and they provide a toolbox to use when encountering learning difficulties. There are 3 main learning theories: constructivism, behaviorism, and cognitivism. Today, I'm going to focus on constructivism and share some key things to know. But you know, we've got the other theories covered in the 240 study guide. Constructivists view learning as a process where students build upon the prior information learned. For example, in order to learn multiplication, students must first understand addition and build the concept of multiplication upon that foundation of addition. There are 3 instructional methods you can use in the classroom to tap into the constructivist view of learning: experiential learning, problem-based learning, and inquiry or discovery learning. All 3 of these methods allow the student to take an active role in building new knowledge. The teacher facilitates and provides scaffolding to help students reach independence. Oh, and one more thing. If you hear the word constructivism, you need to think of this name: Lev Vygotsky. Vygotsky was a social psychologist who developed the idea of the zone of proximal development, which shows what tasks a learner can do independently, can do with assistance, and cannot do. Providing experiences within the child's zone of proximal development allows them to build on these experiences and increase their knowledge. I guess you could say you really want them to be in the zone during class time. At last, we've made it to the final competency. The last one is reading programs. Questions here are going to involve planning and implementing the reading curriculum and coordinating all of the people that make a reading program happen. Let's hone in on working with other professionals within the reading program, specifically paraprofessionals. Subscribe to the 240 Study Guide to get all the information that you'll need to know for this section. Working with paraprofessionals, or paras, is a key part of this competency and a key part of being a teacher. Typically, much of a para's time will be spent working one-on-one with students or in small groups while the teacher gives direct instruction to other students or the entire class. Here are my tips for working effectively with paras. First, outline the expectations and requirements beforehand. This will minimize the chance for miscommunication as well as enhance the efficiency of the supplemental work done by the paraprofessional. Notes, answer keys, or examples of the student's work can be beneficial. Have a procedure in place to ensure that the work is being done properly by the para. This might include checking in with them and their group of students or reviewing the student's work or products. And most importantly, maintain an open line of communication with your paraprofessional, so that way they feel valued and free to communicate any confusion and difficulties with the task. In my classroom, I had a basket right by the door with specific activities I'd prepared for my para to complete with her group of students. Before school started, I met with her for a few minutes to model the activities and answer her questions. If you establish a routine and communicate often, you will be set up for success. You did it! You invested the time in yourself and you reviewed all 9 competencies for the reading K-12 exam. I'm so proud of you! Now that we've gone over some of the big concepts in our 9 areas, let's look at some practice questions to show you how those concepts might appear on the test. Now, if you want a lot of practice questions, you can click the free practice test below. At the end, you get a score report on how well you did on the test. And then you can go subscribe to the 240 Study Guide and get all the practice questions you need to be 100% confident for the test. Now for questions. Remember, we started with competency 5, and I told you about the stages of word recognition. Let's take a look at how that is reflected in a question. A small group of first grade students are in the pre-alphabetic stage of reading development. In order to remediate these students and move them into the partial alphabetic stage, the teacher should provide instruction on letter sound correspondence and letter names, onsets and rhymes and high frequency sight words, morphemes and syllables, or reading sight words in isolation and within complete sentences. This is the correct answer. The feedback provided in the 240 practice test would tell us that the pre-alphabetic students are still working on recognizing letters and the sounds that they make, so instruction in this area would be appropriate. Now let's take a look at a question from competency 6, phonics and word recognition. A student who is struggling with phoneme blending would be unable to replace the letter O in dog with I and correctly say dig, start with the word blend and generate other words like send, end, and lend. Read the phonemes and erst and correctly say thirst. Or remove the er from trip to make the word tip. This is the right choice. This student is struggling to blend the onset and rhyme of words together to correctly say the word. What about those tricky vocabulary questions? What do those look like? Which set of words below would fall into the category of tier 2 words? Stop, change, draw, prevent, contrast, diagram, lava, magma, geode, or eclipse, celestial, orbit. This is the correct answer. These terms represent tier 2 words because they're high frequency words that would appear in many subject areas and they require clear instruction and review. And what about those questions about fluency and comprehension? What could those look like? A fourth grade teacher is planning a lesson to help facilitate student use of metacognitive skills to require students to self-monitor while they're reading a text. Which of the following activities would she use in this lesson? Ask them to read the story a second time aloud to their neighbor. Provide a short quiz at the end of the story that'll be graded together. Pair students and require them to stop at multiple pre-selected locations in the reading of a text to perform think-alouds. After reading, draw a picture of one of the characters from the story. This is the right choice. The think-aloud activity will require students to stop periodically to think about what they're reading. This is a metacognitive skill. Now for the text types and structures category. Which of the following is contained in most poetry and drama? Dialogue, theme, meter, or plot? So this is asking about a shared feature of poetry and drama. This is the right answer. Most poetry and drama contain a theme. Dialogue would typically only be found in drama. While some drama contains meter, it is more commonly associated with poetry. And most poetry, with the exception of narrative poetry, does not contain a plot. Let's throw you a tricky question from the reading assessment and evaluation category. Which best describes the purpose of an informal reading inventory? To assess a student's interest and engagement in reading, to assess a student's reading fluency and vocabulary, to assess a student's oral presentation skills, or to assess a student's oral reading skills and comprehension. This is the correct one. Informal reading inventories are used to assess a student's reading fluency and comprehension. Now, on to the supporting reading competency. During a whole group discussion of a classroom chapter book, the teacher asks, at the end of this paragraph, Matilda decides that she no longer wants to be friends with Jane. What causes Matilda to make this decision? Which level of question-answer relationship questions is this an example of? Author and you, on my own, think and search, or right there? This one's the right one. Answers to think and search questions are in the text, but they may require students to analyze the text and think critically. If Matilda doesn't expressly say, I'm not going to be friends with Jane because X, then this is the think and search style question. Let's look at some research and theories questions. Which of the following is not a method used within the constructivist learning theory? Social learning, scaffolding, zone of proximal development, problem-based learning. This is the correct answer. We talked about the other choices earlier in the video while going over constructivism. Social learning theory was developed by Albert Bandura and suggests that children learn by observing others. This theory assumes a person does not have to experience something in order to learn it. When they imitate the behavior, there will be a consequence, and if it's positive, then they're likely to repeat it. You made it to the last practice question. This one is from Competency 9, Reading Programs, and it's about working with paras. Mrs. Kemper is excited to find out that she will be receiving a new paraprofessional, Sarah, for her second hour class. After meeting Sarah, Mrs. Kemper asks how confident she is with identifying supporting details, which is the topic of that day's lesson. Sarah replies that she feels confident with the topic. So Mrs. Kemper pulls three students who've been struggling with finding supporting details off to a table to work with Sarah, and then she begins an enrichment activity for the rest of the class. After about 10 minutes of working with the whole group, Mrs. Kemper walks over to check on Sarah's group's project. Mrs. Kemper is disappointed to discover that the group has made minimal progress, and any answers that have been written down are incorrect. What could Mrs. Kemper have done at the beginning of this interaction to ensure that Sarah and the students had a positive learning experience? Give Sarah a group of students who are proficient with this topic, so Sarah will have an easier time. Walk through the activity privately with Sarah to be sure she's confident performing the task and provide Sarah with an answer key. Introduce Sarah to the students and allow them to get to know each other before beginning the activity. Or let Sarah choose where she wants to work with the students so she'll feel comfortable while teaching. This is definitely the right answer. By providing a quick overview of the lesson and working through it quickly, Mrs. Kemper can be sure Sarah knows what is expected of her before she interacts with students. Now, that's just a small sliver of practice questions to give you an idea about how these concepts are assessed on the test. Congratulations on finishing the video. If you found it helpful, give it a like. There's still plenty more to learn. Did you know that 240 has helped thousands of teachers in Florida pass their certification exams? If you really want to make sure that you're prepared for the FTCE Reading K-12 exam, take the next step and subscribe to the 240 Study Guide. It has hours of video, so you can watch or listen on the go. It's test-aligned, so you know precisely what you need to study. And it has hundreds of practice questions, so you can be sure you're ready. And who can forget the money-back guarantee? Come on, click the link below right now and get started.